Dr. Bergman will speak to the just war theory, while Mr. Swanson will speak against war altogether. They will both have a chance to present their case, and each will have the opportunity to respond to each other twice. We will then move into a question and answer session. So, without further ado, please give a warm St. Michael's welcome to Dr. Roger Bergman and Mr. David Swanson.
Essays, the title of which is Should War Be Eliminated? Should War Be Eliminated? I think he makes the best case possible for Christian pacifism. I'm not going to go into that, his argument for that, but I do want to quote him to get started here. He says, the debate between pacifism and just war thinking is a theological issue of how we are to read and interpret history. I don't think my students can make sense of the history of this question within Christianity if they don't understand that. It may not be to the end of the semester that they get that, but I think most of them do. So I'm going to come at the question from an explicitly theological point of view. There's some big words in there, so let me try to explain them. So I call this slide the three E's of Christian ethics of war and peace: eschatology, ecclesiology, and of course, ethics. Eschatology, you can see it right underneath that fancy term, is the relationship of the kingdom of God with this earth. Scholars agree that the principal message of Jesus was the kingdom of God, or the reign of God. Well, what does that mean? Where is it? When is it? What does it look like? The term eschatology comes from the Greek eschaton, meaning end times, associated with the kingdom of God, which is, in Christian belief, the point toward which we're headed. The question is, in the life and teaching and death and resurrection of Jesus, how much of that kingdom has been made present in this history, in this world? That's, I think, the fundamental question, and it's one that we usually don't get to. But I think that sets the framework for everything else. But if you move from eschatology one step further, you move to the question of ecclesiology. Depending on where you lay your eschatology, you're going to have a different ecclesiology. That's the question of the relationship of the church to society, to the world. Different eschatologies lead to different ecclesiologies. If you are Amish, you have a certain eschatology, and you live that out in your Amish communities. If you are mainstream Christian, Catholic, Lutheran, Presbyterian, and so forth, you have a particular eschatology that's prominent in your tradition, and that leads to a certain ecclesiology, an understanding of how the church is supposed to be in the world. The third E, of course, is where we are coming in. That's the question of ethics. And in this case, the ethics of war and peace. And I describe that here, as you can see in the underlying there, the relationship of the disciple, the Christian disciple, to the state. Now, let me give you three examples of how this plays out. And then I'm going to run with the third. So, Calawas himself, as a pacifist, has a realized eschatology. He believes that in the life, death, resurrection of Jesus, the kingdom has been realized on earth. The kingdom has been realized. That means that the job of the church is to live out that reality. That usually takes the form of a retreat from the mainstream life of the world into Mennonite communities, farming communities, Amish communities. Our loss is a little more ambitious than that, but it's basically in our congregations, we will practice the kingdom of God. We will learn what it means to forgive, to be reconciled, and to be brothers and sisters to one another. I ask my students, how is it possible that the Amish, when several of their children were murdered, was it 10, 12 years ago now, were able to forgive that murder? And the answer is because that's what they practiced in. The same thing can be said about the Baptist Church in Charleston after what, 8 or 9 of their members were brutally murdered in a prayer meeting. And the first response, we forgive. How are they able to do that? They practice. That's what they understand it means to be Christian, to be a disciple. If you take this approach from eschatology as realized to ecclesiology as living out that reality in the church, then your relationship to the state is going to have to be one of conscience objection. You are a pacifist. The conventional peace churches, Mennonites, Church of Brethren, Quakers, this is what I'm talking about. So that's just one example, but it's one of the most prominent and clear cases. I often tell my students if I had to reduce my syllabus to 2 essays, be Calawas and an article by Reinhold Niebuhr, which I just taught yesterday, titled Why the Christian Church is Not Pacifist. So it's at the other end of the spectrum. If Calawas and his perspective is described as Christian witness to the kingdom, Niebuhr is described as a Christian realist. We have to deal with the wider world, with history as it is, and for Niebuhr, that world is characterized by sin. So his eschatology is that the kingdom is very future, very future. Jesus made a difference, but it's mainly a difference of mercy. It's not all of a sudden you're able to live the law of love. The gospel of Niebuhr is the gospel of forgiveness and mercy because we can't live fully, completely the law of love. So for Niebuhr, the whole point of the church is to try to make as much difference in the world as our own sinfulness allows. he would say, you are always dealing in the world with conflicts among sinners, even those who are on the right side are still sinners. So he had a minimalist sense of what was achievable in this world, but that didn't keep him from being a very committed social justice activist. But if you take this perspective, you are likely to end up on that final category as a just warrior. That's part of what it means to be in this world, achieving as much justice and as much peace as possible, even though it will never even closely approximate the kingdom of God, which is so far removed from our sinful world. So the third alternative, and the one I want to affirm to you tonight, is exemplified by the 1983 pastoral letter of the U.S. Catholic bishops, The Challenge of Peace, God's Promise and Our Response. I became Catholic the same year that letter was published, and I've been teaching it and promoting it ever since, because it makes sense to me. It's not just because it comes to us on the authority of the bishops. It certainly got my attention as a new Catholic. The bishops, I think, strike the right balance. The famous phrase from that letter is, the kingdom is already, but not yet. Already, like our law says, but not yet, like Hebrew says. It's not one or the other, it's both and. That complicates things, but it seems to me it makes it more capacious, more comprehensive of the realities that we face in this life. That means their ecclesiology is one of being in the world, but trying to transform it. They have more, there's more hopefulness there about what is possible. Sin is not the only story. There is also grace at work. There is the Holy Spirit at work. So we can make a difference. Since the time of Vietnam War, the late 60s and into the 70s, the U.S. bishops have repeatedly been on record favoring selective conscientious objection. So not pacifist conscientious objection to all war, and not simply, I will go to whatever war I'm ordered, if I'm a warrior, but I will make a judgment about every war my country is involved in, and I will respond accordingly. So, you can't see it, I'm sure, but I have a little icon that I brought with me to remind you of what I'm talking about here tonight. That's an icon of Blessed Pontiacus, who 9 years ago was beatified by Pope Benedict. Jagerstatter was a 35-year-old Austrian peasant when he was conscripted by Hitler's army. And he refused. He refused. Despite the fact that he had three young children, despite the fact that his wife wanted him money to serve, despite the fact that his pastor and the neighboring pastor urged him to serve, it's not your responsibility to make a judgment about the war our country's involved in. Despite the fact that his bishop, the Bishop of Linz, Austria, told him it was not his judgment to make you serve, he refused. I don't know how, with an eighth grade education, he got so much insight into this tradition, but he looked at Hitler's wars and said that those wars are unjust. If I join them as a soldier, I would be a martyr. And so he refused. And so he was court-martialed, sentenced, and beheaded. 1943, on August 9th, the Feast of the Transfiguration. It took a while that the church has come to recognize this as a saint. So I hope in my lifetime that we'll be talking about Saint Augustine. So he's my hero. I'm writing a book on selective conscience objection. He's the first chapter. He's the example. He's the inspiration. Okay. I'm going to leave that up so you can meditate on it as I try to say something more about the just war theory. An appeal to the Catholic Church to recommit to the centrality of gospel nonviolence. The statement from the conference sponsored by the Pontifical Council on Justice and Peace and Fox Christi International rightly acknowledges the dangers of misguided use of just war language. but in calling for jettisoning that tradition, the statement endangers the just peace it hopes to promote. This conference happened last April. The U.S. Catholic Bishops passed a letter in 1983, the Challenge of Peace, embraces a hopeful but realistic eschatology. The kingdom of God is already but not yet inaugurated but not yet fulfilled, and takes nonviolence seriously in this context. It teaches a strict interpretation of the just war tradition, of the right of nations to defend themselves, and places a high responsibility on personal conscience, endorsing pacifism, but also selective conscience subjection, the right of soldiers to refuse participation in wars judged unjust, such as did Grand Jackson. I find the richness of this perspective missing from the appeal of the document that came out of that conference tonight. No Catholic should take exception to the call, quoting, for our church to be a living witness and to invest far greater human and financial resources in promoting a spirituality and practice of active nonviolence and in informing and training our Catholic communities in effective nonviolent practices. If even a minority of Catholics were to take up this challenge, it would make a difference. I must, however, take exception to the stated belief that there is no just war. Too often the just war theory has been used to endorse rather than prevent or limit war. Still quoting the conference document. Suggesting that a just war is possible also undermines the moral imperative to develop tools and capacities for nonviolent transformation of conflict. The obvious example is the Allied war against the Axis powers in the 1940s. Certainly Hitler's wars were not just. So to oppose them militarily, since no other effective means were available, was eminently just. Jagerstatter actually said he thought the French and other countries attacked by Germany, his country, Austria, had the right to exist. The Allied bombing of German and Japanese cities, even apart from atomic bombing, was, to cite Vatican Council II, a crime against God and himself, and man himself, and merits unequivocal and unhesitating condemnation. But defeating Hitler's racist totalitarian imperialism by discriminate and proportionate means was a high moral imperative. Do the authors of the conference statement believe that could have been done nonviolently? Do they think such a threat could never rise again? No doubt, just war theory has been used improperly, even cynically. That all wars are unjust on at least one side does not mean that all sides in all wars are unjust. And maintaining that war can be undertaken as a last resort does not necessarily detract from the imperative to avoid war whenever possible and to develop means to do so effectively. But it is the recommendation of the conference statement that the Catholic Church no longer use or teach just war theory. So how will the Church evaluate future wars? Even pacifists have to make an argument if they want to be taken seriously in the public debate. And condemning all wars is not likely to get traction when innocent citizens are under attack. There are other weaknesses in the document, especially its treatment of the Bible. First, the New Testament does not require jettisoning the just war tradition that arose in post-biblical times. While the teaching of Jesus does not explicitly provide a warrant for using force to defend neighbors against attack, neither does it prohibit using force when others are lacking. Other means are lacking. Love of enemies is not necessarily incompatible with participation in just war. I suspect David would have something to say about it. On the other hand, refusal to defend the innocent by force, if necessary, may be incompatible with agape or love of neighbor. The second problem, Jesus' self-sacrifice does not require abandoning just war. His example of not using force to defend himself, a bilateral situation, does not tell us what he would have done if he came across an aggressor attacking an innocent victim, a multilateral situation. What would the Good Samaritan have done had he arrived during the meeting, not after, if his eternal life depended on it? What if all nonviolent attempts at intervention failed? What if coming between the aggressor and the victim would have led to two deaths instead of one? At what point does the commitment to nonviolence become complicity in violence? Jesus defended the woman caught in adultery with wit, word, and gesture. But what if the mob had not responded as it did? Could Jesus have prevented her death by his self-sacrifice? Beyond scriptural concerns, I would argue that the prevention of unjust war is the most pressing issue, and that abandoning the just war tradition would harm the cause. What if citizens refused to support unjust wars and members of the military refused to fight them? Is that more likely to happen because of widespread conversion to pacifism, or because citizens and soldiers learn to take the just war tradition seriously? The conference statement points to successful nonviolent campaigns as suggesting a credible alternative to opposing injustice militarily. Nonviolence, indeed, has had triumphs in combating tyranny in the 20th century. But few, if any, are examples of stopping international aggression. The Danes resisted Hitler non-militarily, but they did not defeat him. The Allied militaries did that. The U.S. bishops got it right in 1983. We should simultaneously develop strategies of nonviolence and hold to a strict understanding of when war can be justified and when it cannot. But we should not jettison the tradition until it is genuinely obsolete. Saint Pope John Paul II and the U.S. bishops denounced the 2003 invasion of Iraq before it began. Was the problem the tradition, or was it the reluctance of Catholic citizens and soldiers to abide by it? Uncritical social conformity, patriotism, uncritical patriotism, and obedience to authority are the problem, not the just war tradition itself. Let me say that again. Uncritical social conformity, uncritical patriotism, and uncritical obedience to authority are the problem, not the just war tradition itself. I applaud the call for Pope Francis to issue a deeply researched encyclical on these matters. He could do worse than modeling such a teaching on the challenge of this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Roger. Thank you all for inviting me. Thank you all for being here. I confess to knowing you. little to nothing about eschatology, but here's mine in 30 seconds. Where I lived in Virginia, they used to work people to death on plantations. And if one eschatology had been, don't participate, don't own people as slaves, and another had been, just accept the way things are until Jesus gets here, and a third had been, do both of those things, none of them would have come close to mine, which would have been, I would like to think, do everything physically possible to end slavery. That's my position on war. Going back over 70 years to World War II, as most just war theorists do, to find an example to justify what has been the single biggest project and expense of our culture and society for each of those years since then, is a sort of a strange stretch of the imagination. We don't go back 70 years for race relations, sexual relations, culture, food, music, anything at all except war. We go back to a world of colonialism, a world without nuclear weapons, a world without significant knowledge of the tools of nonviolence, a radically different place. And we say, because it supposedly worked back then, let's keep dumping our children's unearned pay, trillions of dollars that could save so many millions of lives, into this criminal enterprise for next year, in case there's a good one next year. Even then, you never really get a clear answer from just war theorists as to whether World War II, on the whole, was just or not, because they sort of admit that it was fought unjustly, but it was initiated justly by the United States. And so I don't know at what point, the way in which it's fought, in the Latin in bello, injustice outweighs the supposed justice of starting. But if we did some other crazy thing, you know, if we sacrificed cats to the moon every year, and it never seemed to do any good, but somebody alleged that 70 years ago it had worked, you know, would we keep doing it? Of course not. Of course not. But, and I don't think that you can imagine a war actually being fought justly, you know, because soldiers are not good Samaritans on the side of a road. They are groups of people, armed and trained and conditioned and told to do what somebody else tells them, against other people told by somebody else to kill for usually fairly obscure reasons. They don't, on an individual scale, engage in just ethical thinking. You know, most deaths in wars are people who were retreating. You know, it's not self-defense on that individual scale. 12 of my top reasons why the just war, World War II, wasn't. Number one, could not have happened without World War I and without the stupid way of ending World War I. And nobody says those were just. Could not have happened without Wall Street's and the West's support for the Nazis for years. The investment in Nazi Germany, without the arms race, without endless stupid decisions that could have been done differently and should be done differently going forward. Number two, the surprise is a myth. Japan was intentionally provoked. The president was 6 days off in his prediction of the attack he provoked. It was not a surprise. It was a means of getting into the war in Europe. Number three, you will not find a World War II poster that says Uncle Sam wants you to help save the Jews. You will not find a word about World War II being about saving the Jews until after World War II was over. The governments of the West, the United States included, held meetings and decided not to accept the Jews, not to allow them to settle somewhere else because the Nazis wanted to throw them out of the country before they wanted to murder them. Peace activists who went to the U.S. government and the British government, went to Winston Churchill and his foreign secretary, Anthony Eden, and said, bring the Jews out on ships and planes. You evacuated all these troops from the coast. You can do it. The United States has got boats and planes and planes. And they said, no, it would be too much trouble. It would be too many boats. It would be too many planes. We can't be bothered. The Coast Guard chased a ship of Jewish refugees away from Miami. We watch our Anne Frank movies and feel self-righteous, but the State Department turned down her visa requests. Right? This notion of humanitarian war is imposed. It's a good thing. It's to our credit that wars now have to be sold as humanitarian. It's not to our credit that we believe it, and it's not to our credit that we, you know, impose it on wars from the past. The justification for World War II at the time was not humanitarian, it was defensive. But the war wasn't defensive. And the idea, you know, Roosevelt had a forged map of the Western Hemisphere, Karl Rovian quality forgery of the Nazis' plan to carve up the Americas right as soon as they finished conquering the Soviet Union, right? Which was never going to happen. Never going to happen. It was not a defensive war. I know it's sort of the heart of U.S. entertainment, and there's shows now with what happens when the Germans conquer the United States, but this was not reality. It at best was defending other countries that were defending other countries. And that didn't have to be, and wasn't in the past. Number five, we know so much more now about what nonviolence can do. We look back at the uninformed, spontaneous, nonviolent resistance to the Nazi regime in Germany, in Rosenstrasse, in Eastern Europe, in Scandinavia, and just imagine what these people could have done if they had been trained. And you know, when the women, the non-Jewish women, were demanding the freedom of their Jewish husbands, and other random people started joining in, and the Nazis got scared and said, "Here you go, they're free." Then you don't go home. Then you come back stronger. But they didn't. We know from studies like Erika Chenoweth's that nonviolent resistance to tyranny, including, although the numbers of examples are much more limited still, but including resistance to foreign invasion and occupation, but primarily resistance to tyranny domestically, are more likely to succeed. And those successes are far more likely to be long-lasting than violent. It is the stronger, and it is the more courageous and principled way to approach injustice. When the Nazis told the king of Denmark to put a Nazi flag on his castle, and he said, "You do that, and a Danish soldier will take it right back down." And they said that Danish soldier would be shot. And he said, "That Danish soldier would be me. And that flag never went up." That's modeling effectively courageous nonviolent resistance. If you're invaded and you don't cooperate with the occupation, there is no occupation. What if the Iraqis had used nonviolence skillfully in a principled way? I'm not blaming the Iraqis for my government destroying their country. But their violent resistance hasn't worked. It is not a model for the U.S. to imitate against some fantasized invasion of the United States. In Palestine, in Western Sahara, in the Baltics, under the Soviet Union, in Lebanon, in India, of course, we have seen nonviolent resistance, and the power and the skill and the knowledge of how it's used is growing. World War II was not for the troops. 80% of them did not fire their guns at the enemy. They hadn't been conditioned to thoughtlessly do it. Most of them suffered, as all participants in war suffer. War is supposed to be natural, inevitable. Raise your hand if you know of any cases of post-traumatic stress disorder from war deprivation. It's always for war participation. It is the least natural thing we've got. The troops were treated better. They were given free college. You know why? Because when the veterans from World War I didn't get paid, they occupied Washington, D.C. nonviolently. And were attacked with chemical weapons. Number seven. Several times the number of people who were killed in the camps were killed outside the camps in the war. So under that mythology, you've got a cure that is many times worse than the disease. We should care about all of those people. Number eight. World War II created all-out war on civilians. It created empire. It created nuclear weapons. It created taxes. It created permanent standing army. It created permanent war. Its effects are lasting. Number nine, The idea of good versus evil is highly overplayed. The United States locked its Japanese citizens in camps, had an apartheid state for African Americans, gave its own African American troops syphilis during the war to experiment on them, gave Guatemalans syphilis during the Nuremberg trials, hired hundreds of top Nazis at the end of the war into the U.S. military, and they fit right in. Number 10, the victor was the Soviet Union. Most of the defeating of Nazi Germany was done by the Soviet Union. That doesn't make a victory for Soviet communism, but it doesn't make a victory for U.S. democracy either. Number 11, it still hasn't ended. There are 100,000 U.S. and British bombs in the soil in Germany, killing people to this day. Number 12, 75 years of making a bad bet after a bad bet after a bad bet on the next Hitler. The second coming of the U.S. national religion of flag worship, the second coming of Hitler, has not worked out. Each and every one of them has not been Hitler. And each and every time the United States has bombed the country because of a caricature of an evil dictator, many of whom were quite evil, hasn't killed them, it's killed people by the millions who lived in their countries. Some 30 countries bombed by the United States, millions of people killed in one-sided slaughters since World War II, dozens of democratically elected governments overthrown. Coming out of the institution of war, Rogers says that the German side was unjust, so the other side was just. Seems clear enough. When people engaged in blood feuds between their families, I'm sure one side was unjust. Did that make the other side just? When people settled their disputes with dueling, I'm sure one idiot with a pistol walking 10 feet away from you was unjust. But would that make you just? Or would that make you a participant in a barbaric practice that we should outgrow, set behind us, and evolve in our history as a people? Hitler is not coming back. Nobody is trying to take over the United States. We have to overcome this irrational fear. Toddlers who find guns in their houses kill many more Americans than do foreign terrorists. Accidents with stairs and furniture kill many more Americans than do foreign terrorists. Let's have a little courage. We can strengthen the rule of law, nonviolence, democracy, aid, diplomacy, now, and make nonviolent resistance to any future attack far more successful. But we have to put just war theory behind us. A humanitarian war is never the best option. It is never the last resort. With the unfathomable amount of money that we put into killing people, we can do amazing things nonviolently that we don't dare dream of. Who arms the world? Put up a map of the countries where the wars are and the countries where the weapons come from, and there's no overlap. We push alcohol on Native Americans and opium on China. The five permanent members of the UN Security Council plus Germany sell 80% of the weapons. The United States, far and away, the leader. The ISIS videos have U.S. weapons, U.S. vehicles, U.S. guns. That region is saturated with U.S.-made weaponry. How is that just? And who invests in that? In the United States, just about everybody and everything. Public retirement funds on down. The preparation for wars is something that we're taught to think of as sort of neutral. Morally, it's neutral. We'll be prepared for wars, and then we'll decide. This war looks just, this war looks unjust. No, the preparation itself is a far greater evil than any of the wars. I'll tell you why. Because the world puts about $2 trillion a year into war preparations. About half of that, about $1 trillion across numerous departments and agencies, the United States government alone. Another big chunk of the U.S. allies in NATO. another big chunk of U.S. weapons sales. $30 billion a year you could end starvation on Earth. $11 billion a year you could end the lack of clean drinking water on Earth. You get into tens of hundreds of billions of dollars a year, you could transform sustainable energy, green energy, environmental protection in ways that environmentalists don't dare dream about. You could radically change this country and the rest of the world for a fraction of what is dumped into preparing for wars, and that is the number one way in which war kills. Do you notice that countries that have free college don't have trillion-dollar militaries? If the United States gets free college, it's going to take a lot more than just war theory to get people into recruiting stations. There's a poll that Gallup did. Asked people in 65 countries, what country is the greatest threat to peace in the world? What country do you think in most of those countries around the world was overwhelmingly the winner?
The United States.
Generous Good Samaritan, global policeman, not really appreciated by the people supposedly being helped, by the people whose nations have been destroyed. This is why President Obama vetoed a bill to let family members of 9/11 victims sue Saudi Arabia, because he said people all over the world might start suing the United States. Now, would you rather have someone whose son was killed by a missile from a U.S. drone take the U.S. government to court, or try to put a bomb in Times Square? Which is better? I'd like to have more court cases, fewer wars, less terrorism. But no, the United States has to be above the rule of law. Which parts of the world have just war theory? I spoke with a woman who was at this conference in Rome in April. She said she spoke with people from around the world there. And in seminaries in the parts of the world where the wars happen, in Africa and elsewhere, sorry, I can't read that. Greek. They don't do just war theory. Just war theory arose with empire, when the Christian church joined empire. Under saints who believed in monarchy and slavery and sexism and racism and killing Jews and heretics, and we've managed to keep the good and leave a lot of that bad behind us. But we've kept war way past its expiration date. Then, of course, you have all the unjust wars. All the wars that we all agree are unjust result from the preparation for wars. The more you prepare for wars, the more wars you get. At least some of the seven current wars the United States is engaged in are probably unjust, according to most people here. And the fact that, if this is like any other room in this country, most people here can't even name those seven countries is part of the problem. And of course, these wars are not only unjust, but counterproductive, as numerous top Pentagon officials blurt out the week after they retire, creating more enemies. Just go up the road to Canada and try to advise them what it would take to create anti-Canadian terrorist networks around the world, how much bombing and invading and kicking the doors they would have to do to accomplish that. And once they'd done it, they would need more investment, more weaponry, and more soldiers to counter what they had created with their wars. Then the weapons get handed to the local police departments, because then the military can buy more of them. And then the military trains the police departments, and has the Israeli government military train the police departments in the United States on how to think of the people they're supposed to be helping as enemies in a war. The violence, the racism in our culture comes out of this culture that imagines you can have a just war. I saw today that the Pentagon spent $590 million last year, not on any, airplane that doesn't fly, but on advertising. On advertising. We got $0 for advertising in the peace movement, to my knowledge. Then we have fewer freedoms after every war for freedom. Right? All of this has to be put into the balance. When you allege that some particular war might be just someday, you have to put on the negative side of the balance all of the disastrous results of maintaining the institution of war, because you could get rid of it if you dropped that theory. Yes, some people who believe in just war theory opposed the Iraq War. Others didn't. Prominent just war theorists like Michael Walzer put op-eds in the biggest U.S. newspapers saying, yeah, okay, or let's have a small war. You know, every single war is always supported with language that comes out of just war theory. Whether it's honest or fair or misused or abused in the opinion of one just war theorist or not, it's there to be misused and abused unless we get rid of it. The criteria that President Obama has created for himself for just drone murders that he never complies with and that has nothing to do with law, you know, that they must be identified and no civilians, and they must be unable to arrest them, and they must be an imminent threat to the United States of America, and so forth. It's never happened. Never met any of these criteria. But it comes out of just war theory, and so people believe it. People believe a fantasy like an Eye in the Sky movie and not what they see on the news, because it's more comfortable. So just war theory has a lot to answer for. And weighing the balance in deciding on any particular war. I have much more to get to, I'm out of time, but you have to look at the entire institution of war and all of its negative impacts, a leading destroyer of the natural environment, of our civil liberties, of our culture, of hope for nonviolence and justice in our culture, and the resources that could be saving millions and billions of lives if you're going to keep this horrible, outdated, ancient, immoral, disastrous institution around. Thank you.
The others blessed the young men as they went off to fight for homeland, country, the Fuhrer. That's why von Jagerstatter deserves the status he is now chief of the Catholic Church as blessed and will be a saint. By the way, it requires two miracles in the Catholic Church to become a saint. Martyrdom is considered itself the first miracle. How did he sum it up, the insight and the courage to do what he did? He said it was grace. He had a dream that was very helpful. He And when asked about the bishops, he said, apparently they were not prepared to make this decision. Although they were probably among the most educated people. Yeah. But they did not take the just war division seriously. If they had, they would not have sent the young men off to fight for them. I don't think I said that the reason World War II can be considered a just cause was because we went over to rescue the Jews. That's not the case, as they would be clear. We only learned about that as we went along. I certainly know the story of the Jews being refused and so forth. That was not the justification for going to war. The justification for going to war was Hitler was invading one country after another and killing lots of people. Unjust. Somebody had to stand up for that. Finally, it had to be part of the United States. I had my own fantasy, of course, that all citizens and soldiers would embrace the just war tradition and take up the selective conscientious option. So I can hardly point a judging finger at David and his fantasies. But you notice that there is a litany of ifs. If this had happened, if this had happened, if this had happened, we would not have had World War II. If we had better meetings, if. But we have to deal with the world as it is. As I think I said in my talk, I applaud nonviolence. I've been committed to nonviolence for a long time. I teach nonviolence in my Christian ethics of war and peace. I know the examples. I know about the Danes, I know about Chile, I know about Martin Luther King. I know about Martin Luther King, I've talked to Gandhi. But we don't have to jettison the just war tradition in order to take nonviolence seriously. And I pray that there would come a time when we're so good at that as a human race, the war will become obsolete. I don't think we're quite there yet. In fact, we're a long way from that. There's too much else in there that I want to try to respond to, but let me just ask you one question. How many slaves are there in the world today? More than there have ever been, despite the fact that slavery is outlawed. Where does that come from? Does it come from the laws against slavery? Does it come from theories of human dignity and human rights? Is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which outlaws slavery, opposes slavery, is it responsible for human trafficking today? I'm from Omaha. We're on the intersection of I-29. Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett's company, has a huge convention every year. We host the College World Series and other sporting events. Omaha becomes a nexus of human trafficking on those occasions. It's all illegal, and it continues. Why is that? If, I'm sorry to sound like an old production, I guess that's maybe what I'm becoming. I don't think if the nations of the world outlawed war, it would stop war. It would be a great thing if we could take that statement. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a great foundation for moving in that direction. The United Nations needs to be strengthened, the Security Council reformed, so it's effective. Share David's critique of U.S. militarism, military-industrial complex, all of that. I wouldn't argue with those anything. But I don't think you can blame all of that on some principles that have been developed over centuries that have tried to put limits and restraints on war as a response to injustice.
Thank you. Yes, if wiser decisions had been made, and World War II or any other war avoided, then that war would have been avoided. FOIA. The reason that's relevant is that sitting around and letting the governments of this world run right up to the edge of creating World War III is not inevitable. It's not forced on us by some law of physics or theology or economics. The United States facilitated, and its facilitation was exposed before the fact, a violent coup in the nation of Ukraine that put in power, among other nasty people, Nazis, liberal Nazis. The United States violating its promise to the then Soviet Union has expanded NATO right up to the border of Russia, has put the biggest military exercises since World War II on the border of Russia, has put missiles in Romania, is building a missile base in Poland, is putting more nukes into Europe, is threatening and lying about Russia. And I saw it in the airport today and read a completely baseless article that had Vladimir Putin looking mean and horrible on the cover of Time magazine with the headline, "Russia wants to destroy your faith in U.S. elections. Don't fall for it." Okay. These sort of stupid acts have likely consequences. We learn that by looking at the past and seeing how horrible things were created by similarly stupid acts. World War III does not have to happen. Nuclear apocalypse does not have to happen. Yeah, rewriting history to avoid World War II would be rewriting history. But we're writing the future right now. And we can write it better. We don't have to accept it, because Jesus ain't here yet. We can make it better. Trial by ordeal, dueling, slavery, plantation slavery, blood feuds, the death penalty. These are all things that have not been completely eliminated from the earth. But they've been eliminated to such an extent that everybody accepts they can be. That we're not doomed to keep them around forever, the way people in this country at this time think about war, and other people in other countries and at other times didn't think about war. I actually wrote a book preparing for this event about just war theory, and we've touched on just about none of it, but just war theory proposes all these criteria, and if a war can meet all these criteria, then it's a just war. And it ignores everything I talked about, the costs of maintaining the whole institution of war. But I looked at all these criteria, and a number of them are just not measurable, just not empirical. Right intention, just cause, proportionality. You can't tell whether some war is proportional or not. It's in the eye of the war maker. Others of them are not possible. Key among those, last resort, but also reasonable prospect of success. Non-combatants immune from attack. When does that happen? Enemy soldiers respected as human beings. It's not usually a central part of respecting someone to murder them. Prisoners of war treated as non-combatants. And others of them have nothing to do with morality at all. Publicly declared, waged by a legitimate and competent authority. It doesn't make the victims feel better. So actually, if you look at all these criteria, and they serve to justify crimes in newspapers, but they don't actually make war just. And the distinction that just war theory creates between ad bellum, that is going to war, and in bellum, that is conduct during a war, is the worst of these holdovers from ancient doctrine, because all the big human rights organizations ignore the fact that, yes, all the nations of the world did get together and outlaw war, and no, they didn't expect it to end war, it didn't. But the Kellogg-Briand Pact bans war, and the UN Charter bans almost every war, including all the current ones. And Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, all the rest of the big funded Western human rights groups, the principled stand to ignore the existence of those laws and just deal in bellum, just look at atrocities during a war. And the result of that has been disastrous for the recipients of these wars. The consideration of conscientious objection, I just had to speak to very briefly, because this idea that it's good for some people to conscientiously object to a war. But not everybody, not if it's a just war. You know, selective conscientious objection to one war and not all wars is a, you know, far better public policy than the US government has. But it's not ethics. Either it's right or it's wrong. It can't be, you know, it can't be, let's have a statement that some people conscientiously object, but let's make sure the war happens as well. This is not a coherent ethical position. We could have a reverse arms race. We could make the United States the leader and the most beloved nation on earth if we turn in the other direction.
He makes the point that the principles of the just war theory in themselves don't do anything. They're just words on paper. People have to take them seriously. Leaders, citizens, soldiers have to take them seriously. The Ten Commandments by themselves don't do anything. They have to be taken seriously. They have to be lived by. And I just don't think that's ever happened with the just war tradition. That's the point I would make over and over again. The examples I've given of two people from World War II, the so-called good war, are that those few people who did it make a difference. There's a direct line from John Ford's article in 1944, a solitary voice about courage went directly to the condemnation that I included in my talk from the Vatican Council against liberation bombing, indiscriminate bombing of cities. It's a direct line. This has been described as one of the greatest essays in Catholic moral theology ever written. Yeah, two more words on the page. People have to take them seriously. I take my violence seriously. We came across a dinner conversation that both of us had protested at the Strategic Air Command, STRATCOM, Scott Paul, at Omaha, the Air Force Base there, because I'm opposed to nuclear weapons. I'm not looking for World War III. I have twin grandsons who I hope will not have to fight World War III. I say to myself, if you are a supporter of the just war tradition, is it possible that there would be some rare occasion in which I could, I could stomach one of my grandsons going out to war. I hate the thought of it, but I have to say I'm not sure that I could say absolutely no. I myself refuse to win the last 2 years of ROTC, it's possible that's here tonight, because had I been commissioned, I would have gone to Vietnam and thought that war was unjust. I lucked out on the lottery. I lucked out on the lottery, so I was not drafted. I went off to graduate school and forgot about it. There's something going on with these principles. People have to take them seriously. They have to think them through. Every theologian who has written about this says these are very difficult prudential judgments, but what in life that's important is it? it's hard. It's hard. We can take this division seriously. I agree with David that most of America is more successful. I teach that. Of course, including your revolution.
Kirill Gorbachev says something interesting in his new books about keeping war around but getting rid of nuclear weapons. He said, as long as the United States pursues such dominance of the rest of the world with non-nuclear weapons, the other countries, the other eight countries that have nuclear weapons, are not going to give them up. The United States, as you may be aware, has a bigger military than anybody else has ever seen. Has several hundred, maybe over 1,000, depending how you count them, bases. We watch sports events and they thank the troops for watching in 175 countries, and nobody blinks. Nobody says, would 174 be enough? Or, you know, shouldn't we really have 176 if we want to feel safe? This is unprecedented. Other nations don't do this. There are about a dozen foreign bases of all other nations combined in the world, you know, compared to the United States Empire. And you can't do it. You can't have wars with just war supporters. Not strict just war supporters. There aren't enough of them. You have a big crowd in the U.S. population wanting to kill lots of people. And another section of the population wanting to bomb a country for its own good to help them achieve democracy and so forth. But you can't have soldiers trained to participate in war and have that culture, have that filter back into our culture without unjust war theory. And most of the just war claims that we hear from our government are lies. I mean, if they actually came up with a just war, if I believed in such a thing, why would I believe them? Why would I believe what they said? Look at what they do with these humanitarian wars. They take a country like Libya and allege that a horrible, in some ways pretty good, in some ways incredibly awful, ruler of that country, until recently a friend, an ally, and weapons purchaser of the United States and the West, is about to massacre civilians. No evidence, no proof, against all evidence, against all logic. He's about to massacre civilians, and they get a UN authorization to go and rescue them. And immediately, without question, and totally understood by everyone, without pause, without additional UN resolution, they overthrow that government. And that ruler is sodomized with a knife and killed. And the Secretary of State, now running for president, goes on TV and giggles and laughs and says, we came, we saw he die. And the weapons go everywhere. And a U.S. trained killer overthrows the government of Mali. And a CIA guy from Virginia heads over to try to run Libya. And the disaster spreads and the disaster spreads. And they say, we had to do that because we could have had a war in Rwanda and we didn't. We're bombing people, never would have done a darn bit of good. And the U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, Samantha Power, writes a column and says, don't look at Libya. Close your eyes. Think about Rwanda so you will be properly prepared to bomb Syria. Always look at the war that didn't happen. That's the one without disaster after disaster flowing out of it. And now the same people and the same former Secretary of State who wanted a no-fly zone, sounds very, non-violent, a no-fly zone in Libya, want one in Syria. Or a safe zone. I don't care if they call it a democratic rights for your pet kitten zone. It's an act of war. It's an act of mass murder. And it's criminal. And for the United States government to allege that Syrian attacks on U.S. troops in Syria is aggression, while U.S. troops that have illegally invaded Syria fighting back is defensive, is to proclaim ownership of the earth, despite the claims of others. This is not how it has to be. Jeremy Corbyn, the Bernie Sanders plus peace activist of the United Kingdom, is ready to disarm and stop the wars and stop the invasions. These are people with the same genes as we have in the United States. We take this 4% of humanity in the United States and we say, well, we're all for war, it must be human nature. Anybody in that other 96% of humanity, all represented by governments that invest radically less in war and wage wars radically less, well, I think that might not be exactly human nature. That's a little quirk in that 96%. You know, let's get some humility. Let's not just try to love our neighbors. Let's try to respect our neighbors and imagine that maybe once in a while we could learn something.
I think if you're going to watch these horrendous election debates,
You should watch them on Democracy Now at democracynow.org because they have four candidates instead of two. And, you know, the trends on many issues related to war and peace, Israel, Palestine, and other particular areas show that young people who are getting their media from other sources have much better, from my perspective, opinions and views and information than do older people who are getting their news from television networks and the New York Times and the Washington Post. And the question, the really tricky question is, how do you grow old and not develop horrible views about the world and keep your well-informed and uncorrupted opinions? And I don't know the answer to that.
I just had, over dinner tonight, several of the students mentioned their global studies programs coming up. One's going to be in three different countries, three different parts of the world in 6 months. It's very impressive. In addition to reading alternative news sources and reading sources from other countries, I think there's a whole lot to be said for going to other countries and experiencing other cultures and meeting other people. It's a lot harder to swallow here in this country as mainstream news as the sole arbiter of the truth. It took 10 students to Haiti in June. I tell you, those students are much more attuned to what's happening in Haiti with the hurricane right now and to whatever is said about Haiti by the international powers who ransacked it for 5 centuries. So there's a lot to be said. It sounds like this is going on at St. Michael's College to get out of the curriculum, middle class America, and go see the rest of it.
So my question is, can you draw a line between security and defense and preparation for war, especially because of the countless atrocities in countries that we have invaded and currently are invading?
I think if you were to take the just war criteria seriously, many of U.S. wars will not have been war. And so we're not all experts who know that tradition are going to agree. That's true of many difficult issues. So when you think of any serious discussion in any press making use of just war criteria about wars, the only example I can think of is George H.W. Bush, first, before the first Gulf War. He took the just war criteria one by one and made his speech and made his case. Whether I agreed with him or not, I appreciate the fact that he was seeing this as a moral issue, as a geopolitical strategy issue. I think that ought to be standard operating procedure. I don't have to worry about that.
Well, I look forward to reading that because my understanding, and I'd like to see your research, is that it certainly looked possible to negotiate Iraq's withdrawal from Kuwait, and that attempt at diplomacy was not seriously made, and much less seriously made 800 times in every variety so that the war could be called a last resort. And I think if you're going to draw a line between self-defensive wars and other wars, then you have to abandon the role of uninvited, hypocritical, opportunistic global policemen and abandon foreign bases and abandon weapons that have no defensive purpose and, in other words, scale back the majority of the United States military and have, you know, maintain your belief in defensive militarism, but make it actually defensive. Make the U.S. military resemble militaries of other countries and defend its coasts. The great Marine-turned anti-war advocate Smedley Butler said, let's keep the United States military within 200 miles of the United States. Can you imagine the good that would have done for the world if it had been listened to all those years ago?
I must admit that I am at times an objective of war, but I'm one who always wants to listen to the other side and understand. There was one question this evening, which I don't think was addressed. I've had this discussed with many people. I've written that just to be clear for people's eyes. How can a theologian or an ethicist or anybody decide which war is just? I lived in Germany many decades, understanding the exceptionalism that was the basis of the Nazi regime. I now live in the USA, a country that sees itself as exceptional, as the best in the world. In a country that believes the arrogant theory that it's very much better than all others in the world ever have the ability to develop an unbiased understanding of the conflict, well enough to find a just peace and global war. Which just war will bring us peace?
Suggested in my talk that the German mission fell prey to German exceptionalism. So yes, I agree. I think it's a very difficult problem. And the reason I mentioned Franz Jagerstatter and Father John Ford is that they were men who rose above the common way of thinking on things. And especially with Jagerstatter, of course, it cost him a lot, cost him his life. The fact that it's difficult early means we shouldn't try it. We shouldn't do it. I mean, what David is proposing is honest enough to say we have to be as disciplined and courageous or more to institute nonviolent civilian-based defense as we ask the military to be willing. We all have to be willing to risk our lives. I, in the 80s and 90s, was involved with the Civilian-Based Defense Association, the executive director's friend. He asked me to chair one of his conferences. Maybe it's because I was the director. There were five people who showed up. International conference, five people. That was the reach that I needed at the time. I understand the idea. I understand the idea. I'm all for promoting that idea. At the same time, that I don't think we simply have to jettison just war because it's been so tragically abused. And Chair Avon's order at American Workers, 700 bases overseas, that's not defensible. I agree.
The idea has, of course, gained in popularity and effectiveness, and you should look at organizations like Nonviolent Peace Force and so many others, and the work that unarmed civilian protectors are doing to protect people, to keep kids from being recruited as soldiers, to prevent violence in ways that armed UN peacekeepers are unable. It is surprising if you've been brought up in a different ideology, and it is overwhelming the evidence and the potential and the cost of $50,000 per nonviolent peacekeeper per year in comparison with $1 million per troop in Afghanistan per year, who are the fiscal conservatives. The idea of war for peace, you know, everybody's for peace, the Pentagon's for peace. We had a school board member in Virginia say, I'll celebrate the International Day of Peace as long as nobody gets the idea I'm against any wars. No, you gotta be anti-war. War for peace is fornicating for Virginia. It's nonsense. It doesn't work. A friend of mine, David Hartsoe, sat in at a lunch counter before they were integrated and had a man grab him and put a knife to his throat. He said, I'm going to kill you for sitting with these people at that lunch counter. And David looked him in the eye and said, you do what you think you have to do, brother, but I'm going to keep loving you anyway. And his hand shook, and the knife hit the floor. That's the kind of courage that we do have to have. But we can't just have courage doing stupid, horrible